All right, so now we're getting ready to make a measurement. A very important piece of preparing for your measurement is accurately measuring your transducer depth. Some people ballpark this or estimate this, which we definitely do not recommend, because an accurate transducer depth leads to an accurate discharge measurement. And that's because this transducer depth is factored into the final discharge. So it gets calculated into the area, and the discharge is the area times the velocity. So if we have an inaccurate transducer depth, depending on how wide our channel is, we could have quite a big error in our total area for our site. So the transducer depth is defined as from the water line to the face of the vertical beam or the center transducer on SonTek ADCPs. So it's not just the distance that the ADCP is protruding below the bottom of the board, it's actually the distance from the vertical beam to the water line. So we put the boat, and we put the Hydroboard 2 Micro in the water, and I know the water line is right at this break on the side of the board. And keep in mind that might be a little bit different depending on what you have, how you have your Hydroboard 2 Micro set up. So GPS, no GPS, RTK. So I'm gonna measure it. And so to measure it today, I'm gonna use a metric frame or square because we're operating in metric. So you wanna measure from, so I'm gonna go perpendicular to the vertical beam to the edge here. So I have a transducer depth of 7.5 centimeters. And we're operating today with the transducer pushed as far down as we can get it, because as you'll see behind me, we're at the Blue River near Breckenridge, Colorado, and it's in high flow. So this is the best site we could find, but it's somewhat turbulent. There's some standing waves, and we do not want the transducer to come out of the water, because the transducer needs to stay submerged to make a good measurement. The acoustics cannot transmit through the air and make a good measurement. So measure your transducer depth, make sure to enter your transducer depth. Now we're gonna step on over to the software and into making a measurement. All right, now that we've chosen a site, we've measured our transducer depth, we're ready to jump into the RSQ software and set up our measurement, do a compass calibration, then get the boat in the water and make a moving boat measurement. So, first off, open up the RSQ software and then click on the new data collection icon. Then select moving boat or stationary. For this case, we're gonna be choosing a moving boat measurement, and then a connection dialog will come up. Automatically, it should show SonTek BLE dongle, and then the last RS5 instrument you used by serial number, or you can hit click scan for devices and it'll show any that are on in the vicinity. So I'll pick this one because this is live and connected to it now. So now I'm connected to the RS5 instrument and I'm showing the smart page here in RSQ. So the great thing about the smart page is you can just start at the top, work your way to the bottom, and once you've have changed any red X's you see here on the left-hand side to green check marks, that means you've gone in and updated or configured your system and you're ready for a measurement. So the top section is just the system information. So that has the firmware version, the software version, and the RS5 serial number. The next section is system test.
So the system test is going to check communication with the temperature sensor, the compass, and it's also gonna check the battery voltage. If we have issues with any of those three things, we'll receive a warning once the test is complete.
So we have the system test passed. So I'm gonna close that out. And now I'm gonna make sure to enter my site information. So this next section on the smart page, I'll click change and enter the site name. We're on the Blue River near Breckenridge, Colorado. This is not a particular station number, but we'll call it one. Location, down stream of Dillon Dam. And then operator is gonna be Brittany Jenner. And the vessel, that we're using the Hydroboard 2 micro today. And this is measurement number one. Gauge height, we don't have a gauge height, but there's a place to put your start gauge height when you're starting your measurement. Comments, this is high flow, and we have a little bit of wind. It's good to put the weather because this is something you can't recreate after the fact. And so I click OK, and now the site information section is complete. We have a green check mark. Now we're gonna go in and we're gonna step into a compass calibration. So first I click on view or calibrate the compass, and this pops up the compass calibration screen and the results from the previous compass calibration. We have not yet calibrated the compass at this site. It's important that you calibrate the compass every time that you go to a site. As setups and conditions can change that affect the compass calibration. So I'm gonna click start, and when I click start, I'm gonna let Brittany know that she can start the compass calibration, also known as the compass dance at SonTek. And what she's gonna be doing is making two rotations, but I'll step into that as she does the dance. So click start. Wait for a minute for the screen to start refreshing. Now I see data coming from the compass. Okay, Brittany, start dancing. So she's gonna make two revolutions, and she's gonna try and time it so that she's doing 60 seconds per revolution, and she's varying the boat's pitch and roll through the pitch and roll that we expect to see. So see, it's a high flow. We have some standing waves on the surface, so she's giving it a good amount of pitch and roll. Okay, 30. And I'm calling out the seconds so that she knows whether she should speed up her rotation time or slow down her rotation time, so that she can try and hit 60 seconds per rotation. And 120. So she's done two full rotations and it's been 120 seconds. So I'm gonna click finish. And then now I get feedback. Compass calibration passed. Do you want to save the calibration on the instrument? Yes, it passed. I'm not gonna say no and repeat. So now we have calibrated our compass and we can close this window. So next we're gonna go in and configure the system for making the measurement. So I'm gonna click change on the system configuration section. Earlier we measured the transducer depth and it was 7.5 centimeters. So this is in meters. And the magnetic declination, so this is what lines up our GPS orientation with the magnetic compass that's inside of the instrument. And you can look this up. In the United States, and maybe it works worldwide, there's a, if you search MagDec, a NOAA website will come up, and if you allow it to use your location and you have cellular service, it will give you your magnetic declination. So we've looked it up for this site and it's a positive 8.3 degrees. Screening distance, this is only if you think that there's gonna be some kind of flow disturbance that below that's affecting the velocities measured just underneath the ADCP. So an example is making a moving boat measurement from a manned boat that has a relatively deep draft. We're using from the Hydroboard 2. We don't need to enter a screening distance. The GPSX offset is if your GNSS antenna is not directly over the RS5. So we're using the SonTek RTK on the Hydroboard 2 micro setup, and the GNSS receiver is located directly over the RS5. So that's zero offset. But if you're making you have your own setup and you have your GNSS antenna on the boat and it's offset from the RS5, then you'll need to put in an offset. Next, salinity. This is very important if you actually have salinity. We're here on the Blue River and it's fresh water, and so we don't need to enter a salinity. The salinity is effectively zero. And then temperature override, we don't have a temperature override because we had a system test. The temperature sensor inside the RS5 is working correctly. And then we don't have a internal compass heading correction or a sound speed override. The heading source, we're gonna use the SonTek or the system magnetic compass. The other option is a GPS or GNSS compass. But right now we don't have that connected, so we'll use the internal magnetic compass. Our coordinate system, we're gonna go with the default, which is ENU, which is earth coordinates, so east, north, and up. And then for depth reference, we're gonna use a vertical beam. For track reference, we've already previously done a track, and we saw we had some missing bottom tracks, because as you can see, this is a very high flow condition, and we're missing some bottom track samples enough in a row to cause a problem. So we're gonna switch that over to GGA for reference. Now click OK. And so that now the system configuration, you see the green check mark, that section is complete. Next, we'll go down to the edge configuration. So this is for the edges. We can't measure the water velocity all the way up to zero depth. So we need to stop at the edge, measure an average of velocity, and then extrapolate to zero at the bank. So now I'm gonna move on into the edge configuration. I'm gonna click change. We're looking downstream, we're on the left bank. So start edge is the left bank, so we don't need to change that. If you're starting on your right bank, you can hit the drop down and change the bank you're starting on. The distance to the bank in meters. So this is another piece where sometimes people just take a look and they estimate it and they plug it in. And it can be good, it can be okay depending, but if you can measure it, you absolutely should, because this is gonna directly affect the area that we measure, and the area is used in calculating the discharge. So we're gonna accurately measure the edge distance. So Brittany, can you measure the edge? Move the boat and measure the edge. And so Brittany's slowly moving the boat out into the transect. And then once we get out into the main water velocity or the edge of water, we checked earlier while running this system just in preview mode to see where we're getting enough samples. This cross section is deep very early, so we don't have to move out too far before we're getting a good number of samples. So when Brittany measures the edge distance, the edge is defined as the distance from the wetted edge to the center beam, like to the RS5, so the center beam of the RS5. And Brittany is gonna mark both the top and bottom ropes on our bank operated cableway so that we can measure this edge distance once and enter it into the software, and then we can bring it back and stop it in exactly the same place each time. So there's a definite a very positive indicator when we're right back in the same location. It's one of the advantages of using a bank operated cableway. And for measuring our edge distances, you can use a tape measure, a rigid tape, like folding tape, so that you can get the distance you need. Also, you can use a laser rangefinder for the far bank if you can't get to the far bank to measure. So Brittany has measured 2.08 meters. On the left bank, we measured the right bank earlier when we were on that side, and that is 3 meters. Then next we have the edge method. So is it sloped or vertical?
Sloped.
So it's a sloped bank. When we set up the tagline, the right edge, the far bank, is also sloped. So those are both sloped. You have the option of choosing user estimated, vertical bank, or sloped on both edges. Vertical?
Yeah, it's vertical.
Okay. So Brittany took another look and it's a vertical bank. So on our left edge, we have a vertical bank. So this is very important that you get accurate edge estimates because this is gonna get added to your total area. So if you're estimating and you're overestimating the distance, you're adding more area. Or if you're estimating and you're underestimating, you're shortchanging your total area. You're gonna have a smaller than real total area for your cross section. All right, and so one of my favorite features, automatic features in the edge collection is this enable auto edge profile. So you can enable this or not enable it, but what it means is that if you enable it, it will take, once you click start collecting edge data, it will collect edge data for 10 samples, and then the software will automatically switch into transect mode, and then you can start moving. It's a couple less button clicks per transect. Because on the same thing, on the far bank, when you hit in transect, it's gonna collect 10 edge samples, and then it's gonna complete the transect for you. And then when you click start on the far bank, it's gonna collect 10 edge samples, and then automatically switch into transect mode. So I think it's a good feature. If it throws you off, you can turn it off if you're used to using it a different way. All right, so that's the edge configuration. You can also go in and change your extrapolation configuration. I'm gonna leave this at defaults, and we'll talk about this a little bit later, but you can launch and after completing your measurement, you can launch and review your data in extrap. And then you can also export your data to QRev to do some post-processing and determine what you can change these after the fact, after the measurement. And then calculation thresholds, I'm gonna leave those as defaults as well. So that's basically, you can change the SNR and enable cell screening. Not something that we need to use right now. So, okay, I've gone through the whole smart page and we are now on the edge, and we are ready to make a measurement.